Another great team fighting drone. First saw for eHome. All right, an ice classic. You've got
here. It looks like he's not even going to be on the Tim Assault.
Oh, wow, you're right. He's going to play the Morphling.
Yeah, so okay. All chicken. His Lone Druid is amazing, but he's the carry player. They've actually rolled around for like Manila. It was ice on support with Lanham playing carry. Lanham is back to support. Ice back to the off lane, and old 11 is in carry now instead of off lane. So yes, they've done a bit of role swapperoo. So I wonder if this means Lone Druid's going to the safe lane, or because it's like they want to run it off lane for old 11.
Yeah, they've got a lot of options. The Tim Assault's a really interesting pick here. It's a fairly heavy lineup, great against Alchemist, or just the minus, good against the Undying as well. I think it's a pretty solid pick.
Yeah, it's gives them some good deep push. It's very good at bursting down the Alchemist as well. Burst damage no longer going to be an issue when you talk about Morphling, Timbersaur, and Lion. And I guess the Morphling, if it is an off laner, utility Morphling, maybe not going to have as much in the way of burst. And Ice is going to be going off lane, it looks like. So don't expect a huge amount of farm coming out from him, but the Timbersaw, this is a Timbersaw game.
Yeah, and the Bloodstone just got buffed. That's another he classically likes to go for. Now starting with 12 charges, actually pretty big.
So last pick was Nyx Assassin for FDA. The big concern for FD's lineup is that your carry slash late game potential is purely in the Alchemist. So when Ehome have drafted around being able to deal with and somewhat counter the Alchemist, the Timbersaw pick being the big one, you kind of have to worry a bit for them because they're all in on this one hero, and that one hero will get countered.
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, one of the changes that I love about this patch is now we're seeing heroes almost always now. It's like mandatory TP right at the beginning of the game and get those wards down before you can be easily scouted. And part of that is just the byproduct of TPs now being 50 gold, which still seems crazy to me. You know, it's in recent memory when they were 135 each.
Holy man, Slax's camera speed? He's on 7,000 camera speed?
Yeah, gotta go fast and speed gaming.
I don't know how you play dead with this.
I don't know. Maybe that's his observing setup.
I feel like this is like matches Slax's like personality. It's like all over the place, like zipping around here and there.
My, that is pretty crazy though. Hard to
imagine. Sensitive. Okay.
And
so,
still no level 1 wind lace. Something I've also been curious about. If it's actually an item worth buying at level 1 to get that movement speed boost over boots, but
I saw one player do it early today. I think it was a Winter Wyvern, I want to say.
Okay.
It's great on supports. Like, if you've got a support, you can, like, the boots first support maybe becomes a wind lace first support.
Yeah.
And it's a slightly cheaper option.
Yeah. I think we'll start seeing it a little bit more frequently. I haven't seen it yet in any of the games that I've cast so far in China, so.
Oh.
Looks like Lone Druid will be down in the bottom lane for some safe lane farm. And they're going to put the Timbersaw mid for Ehome's side.
Yes, so Timbersaw versus Alchemist.
Lana, I'm going to get a nice counter ward already in the top lane. Nice advantage there.
Ooh, nice. They play Sentry, maybe doing some homework against FTD, recognizing where they like to put their levels.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be a tough lane for the Timbersaw, though. Looks like Undying's just going to hang out nearby. Even though it is melee on melee, it's still hurts to get slapped by Decay this early on.
And Acid Spray is going to struggle quite a bit as well.
Pretty hot up top, actually taking a lot of damage. It's a 2-on-2. Lanham getting pushed back by the Venomancer. Ice going to commit a pretty hot. Doesn't have enough mana. There's the Mango for the waveform. This should be a first blood draw, I think. On the other side, is Lion actually going to die first? No, he doesn't get the last auto attack off. Lanham going to survive against the Venomancer. Though he goes back in, connects with the stun. And Venom will be pushed back. Ice on the way. No mana for waveform, but he's pretty close. Maybe about 15 short. Looks like everyone's going to survive. Close on both sides of the coin, though.
Yeah. Both supports getting ditched by their carries who are going for the opposing support.
Now down bottom, Nyx are getting caught by the Telekinesis. Lone Druid putting a lot of damage. I don't think they'll have enough damage for the first blood here. There is still an Impale if they continue to die. One more auto attack. They'll actually get it. It's Venmir that draws it on the roof with the bonus build.
Well, that's not the start we were hoping for. And Lone Druid with Bounty Rune, free time in this bottom lane is going to have a fantastic time. Lion Suicide's the true creep top, so he's going to get nice and to return to this lane. And I feel like Ehome are going to be able to contest all three lanes now that they're running this dual lane setup.
Yeah. Certainly feels like it. Lone Druid should be in great shape, and now Nyx is just getting zoned out hard by the Rubick. He went for the double Mango, so he's got a lot of passive gen here, but still only level 1, and it looks like that's going to be the case for at least next minute or so.
And Doxus isn't awkward here to have camping the mid lane. Yeah, spamming it to Giga is nice and all, but not really putting much of a thing. But what he is doing is lots of stacks in this jungle for the Alchemist. The K does help today. He can stack the big camp while using the K on the medium camps to be outstacked with camps, so
yeah,
it's all in the Alchemist, at least making sure that they continue that trend by going for all these stacks.
Yeah, definitely, I think, needed with an Alchemist in this kind of situation. The offense seems to be going pretty well for Ehom as well. Sexlice only has 4 last hits, but they're also keeping the Venno from farming. He's only at 6 himself. Seems like it's more kind of this war of attrition as they posture around the neutrals rather than just static farming in the lane.
And it's just level 1. That's really the big concern for this hero there. They didn't send someone like the Undying Bot to the lane because they want to give slow speed to a Nyx, but getting complete by a Rubick lane, and they're going to go in for another kill here.
He could follow up again. Stun connects on Rubick. He has a Fade Bolt. There's a lot of damage still to come out. And this should be a dead Nyx Assassin once more. It's Rubick again that gets the kill. That'll make it 2-0 in the first 3 minutes.
It's a really well played by Old 11 there. He positions his Spearfare such that the Nyx can't impale both the Spearfare and the Rubick. And as a result, he maintains the Orb of Venom slow and they get that kill. So just well microed and this Nyx getting heavily bullied.
Yeah.
Big problem.
No doubt. And your point about the Undying mid is completely on point. Old Chicken's actually the leading farmer in the game right now. 15 hits compared to the 12 of the Alchemist in a 2v1 scenario. It's pretty impressive that he's still been able to get so much face time with the creep on here. No point in Timber Chain quite yet. I guess realizing he doesn't really need mobility against these two heroes, the chance of getting into kill is pretty low with active armor having points in it now.
Yeah. I guess safe for now with Sven just staying top, he's very unlikely, and even without as many active armor as does, then he is very unlikely to succeed on this mid lane. Gets clipped by Roshan, so he gets forced to TP out.
Wow. That's unfortunate.
It's not big of a deal as far as the gold. It's only 50 gold now, so
yeah, that's a good point.
But Rubick secures the rune as a result, and also, the TP is something you can use to escape those kills. Like, when you lift it up with the Spirit Bro, you can TP away. Well, now they have 5 Lone Druid, so the Entangle comes to play. And now Lone Druid can just solve this. Nyx is actually... He can't go and tell him. He went for this double Mango. When you go double Mango on Nyx, you're expected to contest lane and get a lot of it.
Yeah.
As a result, when you lose your lane on your field, it's 10 times worse than losing your lane if you're going for an Iron Talon. Because if he has an Iron Talon right now, he just goes and jungles and he's fine, but he can't do that. He's actually going to take over mid. That's how bad things are looking. They give the Nyx the mid lane, Alchemist is going to preemptively into the jungle, and something up to help with the Winter Terror.
Let's see what happens with the position from Pretty here. Stands on the high ground, breaks the smoke, and Fenrir and Law are going to have to find a ski way to make this happen. Alchemist is really low on AP, but they've scouted us out. Radiant, a nice reward here, and kind of a different position. Less likely it'll get sentried. They can see exactly when stacks are coming about. We've got Radiant Vision here. Yeah, they know exactly what's going on. So the right idea to try to contest.
Get there a bit late, unfortunately. Alchemist managed to farm up the entire medium camp outside of the center, which I think he actually got the last hit for the acid, although he didn't get an XP.
Mm.
A level 4 Alchemist rotating the table this early on. Want to contest and ready, but just didn't get.
Well, they could stay on, still continue to this Nyx. It's not good yet. I mean, even the saw do a lot of damage to him now that he assists.
Yeah, this is a sad Nyx game.
Dire's bottom tower
this is not
under attack.
To go around Alchemist now, jungling the camp by the secret drop. Very much, it's like, how can we maximize our just like farm and XP gain right now? And
ooh, rotation mid. Rubick looking for the can't quite get it. Good positioning from here. The live leeching some XP. But this is all coming boss. The Cubs are getting lost in space here. So he's playing up to 1 CS. He's on with Chin still very well. The that we were talking about. This free farming here. Nice rotate over, but fine. This could end that. Yeah, I'm not going
like to. He's going to fall back to the room.
All right.
Yeah, every single lane just going more than okay for Ehome.
Yeah, 1500 worth lead at 6 minutes is nothing to scoff at.
And again, they're looking to come into the dark jungle to get the out.
Oh, here we go, Telekinesis started off magical on the old. Now there's a back to come by the back. I've walked right into it. He gets destroyed by the Timbers.
A lot
in here. If I the Timbers all set, can he just tank? Number D. Therefore, going down. Tombstone not going to do a hell of a lot here. And it looks like Homer is able to get away with only losing one in rear. He gets with the Undying here, and he does. It's a nice little play. Secure survival.
Yeah, but this is always just like base. If you trade one for one in the end of the jungle like that, on FT, as many heroes as they do in, you know your lone druid is not just free farming, but press. And he's going to take the tier 1 tower off. So, to me, big victory in the home way.
Absolutely. Even gets the. I'm trying for it enough, can't quite find it. Looks like Ultron just gonna head into a mice to keep farming here.
Yep. Sure thing. Isn't too really typical kind of lone drip, but I guess Midas into Radiance. I don't see any reason not to this build. Perhaps some era to go like the Yonder build, but.
Yeah, I guess the only reason it may block for it is because of the Morpho replicate that you were talking about, assuming the Alk gets a Radiance can steal it, but
yeah.
Probably
wave from in top, Ice gets a solo kill.
Oh, Dyer's event.
I don't happen to have my camera up. Yeah. I don't expect that.
Yes. Is that use of the rule?
Yeah, he had and Solana, so he ran on top of that. There's low waveform right click.
Look at this though, man. He home. Three heroes in the enemy jungle. They see the acid spray. They're gonna have as many of these creeps as possible. They're gonna be able to leave them in XP. They're gonna stand. Three reapers now. Telekinesis on the Undying. Dungeon from the Lion. Checked on Finch. Lana's taking a lot of damage here. Now the acid spray comes out. They're gonna get cleaned up. Ehome actually gonna be punished for trying to invade the jungle like this. They've already lost one Fenrir on the run. No rendezvous with Ice Idex, but he's so low mana. There's nothing he can do to keep his buff. And with cut rotations, TD will secure the again for Alchemist. Let's go back to farming.
They're kind of over prioritizing trying to just junk at some point. When FT are willing to force back Tombstone spend the other farm, you give him that farm, just use the resource helps when happens. Right now, at home, just getting overzealous with what they can do as far as contesting the Dire Jungle. FTD have set up wards all around it. They've just dewarded two Ehome wards as well, so Ehome's vision in this area is very limited now.
Yep.
So I think Ehome at some point just have to say, look, give Alchemist the farm, we've got interested with him. I'm sure Ice is like, dude, let him farm Radiance, let him get Radiance, just for me, come on, guys. It's not worth dying.
Yeah. Oh, Lana, I'm gonna get caught by a stun, follow-up stun for the Alchemist all the way. He only connects on the Venge, Earthside Hex onto the Alk. The chase is on. Don't think Lana should be able to survive this one, but the Alk actually doesn't have enough mana for Acid Spray the Soul Ring, and now he does. He's gonna be able to damage him. Stun on Vulture on the backside. The Acid Spray still gets the kill on the line, but they should be able to clean this up. Alk's already died. Pretty Hall's on the run. First hit and Tangle, and he will fall. Yeah, Hastrin on the Timber Saw. A little easier for Eho. Still on going down. It was close to fall.
Good headlight. Turn and use that stun to guarantee the kills. He could have kept running and probably outran the Acid Spray and survive, but recognizes he can get killed. Just go to the opponent.
We definitely wanted to kill there as well.
Lone Druid is getting very farmed. He took the bottom, he's coming to the top tower as well.
Dyer's top tower. 2k already, he's just picked up a fight. Meanwhile in the mid, Lanham and Old Chicken gonna pick a fight with the Venomancer and the Nyx Assassin, who's still not level 6 by the way, so they've limited on effectiveness now. Just once he gets Venomancer, he gets some moving around the map. A little more vision for FTD. Look for opportunities to get there. There aren't too many heroes you can pick. Maybe the Rubick will be somewhat able to explore. Not a lot of gank potential for us in this game.
As far as like some of the fights, just like huge plays in some of these lanes, the Morph is double the CS effect. The Manster morphing on 20k net worth of 2%, like that is just absurd. This did in the top lane.
And he picked up a Midas, so that's now double Midas on the side of Ehome. They've already got a pretty sizable lead of 6k net worth.
Considering against Alchemist of all things too. Like,
yeah.
An Alchemist who can Greebles Greed Bomb his jungle, that's impressive right now.
And the Lone Druid still farming and also has hit level 11.
Oof.
Yeah, this Druid's scary, no doubt.
Those Rubik's levels of hell in the bottom gives him some more ganking damage output potential.
Yeah. Even Port Street Homer able to split the lane a bit and leech some XP. Now we got an infused raindrop here. Lions picked it up.
Ooh.
This is kind of an interesting game for it, but I guess if you get caught by one of these big stuns, it's likely to save you.
It's actually a really good audience, Nick. Like, you think of like him roaming around trying to kill people. He doesn't get any damage out of Impale. He gets it reduced. It could save your life.
Yeah, especially Nick, that's kind of behind all. He's right on the cusp of be finding some of his kills. So I would imagine Raindrop certainly enough break point to keep you alive. Alex, he's farming okay here, but Armlet and 2k gold still a little way from this Radiance. Looks like a lone druid will probably beat him to about 3k. Rotations coming in from E-Home, telekinesis, the bear's gonna go charging straight in. Swap from the Venge to try and make some space for the Alf, and that to keep him alive. E-Home start to disengage as they see a TD dumb. That'll be the end of... Still putting a lot of pressure on this quest.
Yeah, that's the thing. When they were, like, dying, had the support from the contest jungle, it's just slowing down the alchemy, disrupting his farm that tiny little bit, and that's the biggest why the lone druid is actually heading right now.
Yeah.
So, things not look good at all for FTD when you've got all three heroes this ridiculously farming heroes. 5k
alchemists just get destroyed, perhaps. Oh, he's gonna turn the fight, puts down the acid spray. They're gonna turn onto Pretty Haw instead. Decent damage coming out there. Out comes the sun from Nick. That's going to the Rubik. And now old Chicken's gonna beat on the run. He's taking a lot of damage. We'll be able to bring him back. I think E-Home actually to get out here. He's gonna be able to get away without conceding any more casualties. Swap for Pretty Haw. Sets it up on the group. Hits him with stun. Now the old best man connects on him too. Isolate is trying to do what damage he can. Won't be enough to save the lone druid. For two trade overall and an advantage for TD.
Not done, Lannis. Back in top lane with a Hex Tail.
And he got him. Alchemist goes down. That makes it a 2-for-2 on the other side. It's Ice versus 3, but he's got a waveform available and a wind lay, so he's pretty speedy. He'll be able to walk away.
Sure, Ice is probably thinking, like, I can actually go carry build this game. And so for me, I've got this Metis. Let's pick up a Lincoln's or something and just go for E-Blitz.
Yeah, he's farming really well. He's been able to get off 1-0. 13 minutes, pretty good,
roughly. Yeah, I'm interested. They wanted to keep this vision of the entire jungle down. Like, they don't care if they get dewarded, they just went back there 2 minutes later, finding new wards in new places.
Yep.
Again, just to limit. Like, this is really. This is Alk's prime farming location, these jungle stacks. He doesn't want to go to the lane too much. He can't go towards the Radiant jungle either, so.
Vengeful Spirit.
Very limited.
Disappears off the map. Danger from Lion Combat. All more than enough to bring him down.
Whew.
Yeah, this is getting hard to contest for FTD. The supports are getting to this point now where E-Home are doing enough damage that if they get caught with one stun or anything that trips them out, it's just an easy kill every time. Top Nyx in dead of form, stalking out the Lion, perhaps thinking about it, but remember, he's got the range up, still 3 charges to go. Timbersaw, I don't know how realistic a kill that is here.
That's not a kill you can get.
Yeah. Especially it's so limited on crowd controls. Undying, level 7. So for a lot of points in decay here.
To a neutral boy.
Up top, there we go. Destroyed by Nick. Nice pickoff. Rubik able to steal mana burn. Maybe not the best.
Yeah. It's like the just the ancients probably fumbled an armlet or something. That's like the kind of faux pas I just couldn't afford. You're already in all sorts of trouble here, so.
Yeah. Although, to be fair, they have kind of stalled out this game. Looking at that war chart, it's been hovering around 5 deficit for the past couple minutes, and that's the best FTT's got so far. I mean, before this, it's just been kind of all downhill for them with every lane getting pushed in. At least with E-Home trying to contest the stacks, it's allowing them to farm in other places and start to recover a little bit. I mean, based on his start, I think he's recovered pretty well. 1400 gold, closing in on the Blink Dagger, already has Arcane Boots. It could be worse on
the stage. This last couple minutes has gone well for them, but it's not like a... It's not a turnaround just yet. I said he's getting ganked up. He's trying to morph through this, but...
He's gonna be tight. And he's waveforming from the high ground, getting low on mana, but Lion's here. He may actually still survive through this. They just simply have the damage to kill the Morphling. Wow. Dire's top tower. Those three heroes still can't bring him down. Two ultimates as well.
Yeah, that's concerning at this point, and... Well, that's going... Heroes pressuring top, heroes farming bottom. E-Home over the last few minutes give kills because they're more than willing to split around the map, recognizing that, hey, you can provide heroes to gank one of us, well, we're not making two of them, so they're always going to be things, a trade somewhere on the map.
Yeah. Big item pickup for the Venomancer, though. Hits the Veil. So that ups his damage out quite a bit. Stop the Nyx, so.
Looks like I said we'll be going into the Lincoln Sphere build on the Morphling. Picks up the Perseverance, at least for now.
Okay. Yeah, playing it safe. Just transition to damage. I'm a little surprised he didn't just go straight for a shotgun or something, like, into the blade. This game, it's got a temp. A guy like Ice Ice, he's going to damn it, you know?
Yeah. Something flashy.
That's the stone temper saw. So old Dickon already pretty tanky. That's another 600 HP since we last checked in on him a few minutes ago with 12 charges on the stone. Good luck.
Towards the lone druid for the bottom of it. It's like he walked away from this. Nick gonna vendetta and when you're a lone druid, you're like 300 gold for the radiant. It's often the case where you just try and get a bit greedy and finish this in the jungle there. Maybe again.
Yeah, they might actually be able to step us up. Pile the vendetta. Drew just laying around here. Looks like his alpha's not gonna like sneak by the creep. Nick is just gonna steal a full hits from him. Cheek little devil. Alpha is closing in on his radiance though. He's got the relic on 1300 gold, so he's almost there. Actually, now Nick can connect with the druid, so his farm is slowly up and up.
Yeah, the problem comes he home with their radiance, and that's we can now push and fight kind of radiance. With Alchemist, it's like I can farm faster radiance. So,
it's true.
Very different approaches now when Dyer's the two radiance are completed, and it's gonna be home for the most part. And start the STD sitting behind their tower.
Yep.
Oh, if you know exactly what. Well, like, they don't know how many. They know at least one, but.
Still a good use of the scan there. Good read that it actually catches four. And now STD will do the same. They keep them on the high ground here. Both sides, some basic intels to react to the lesson, move to the vendetta, and it looks like they'll go into size. No glyph available, this tower pretty much. Might be able to just commit and finish it off. And they are split pushing as well, lone druid in the bottom lane with the bear up front. Rubik, what's he just played wards? That's a tiered tower down to the bottom lane, so all the E home getting advantage out of this. Game shift to the lane.
Nothing like this. You can always be pushed away from the demands because of this like 4-1 split they've got going.
Yeah.
Morphling at least east push considering he's at the spot as he is. And lone druid at bottom. So defend with the Venom, lone druid at bottom.
Yeah. They're starting to draw on every tower. So aside from mid lane, it's not at 3. So they are spending the best points around that here. A lot of play wards in the mid, now that Rubik's stealing it. Or stolen it, rather.
If you're FDD, the way back into this game is through fighting and getting kills, but they don't have an initiator until Nick gets the Blink Dagger.
Yeah, and he's 200 to go away. Kind of don't have to fight right now. But the longer the delay, the harder this gets, the playing now up to the Blinking Sphere, so... It's harder for Nick to kill him. Just harassing Alchemist, trying to steal as many of his last hits as possible. Still pretty unrelenting in that regard.
Yep, stealing a replicate as well on his way, so that's that Radiant replicate to get him too far.
Oh, they find the Nyx Assassin, swap from the Venge, keep him alive, and now pretty hot, a world of hurt. Looks like the team will leave him hot and dry, he'll be an easy kill here for E-Home. Nyx looking to line up the stun, actually misses on the Lanham, and now it's going to cost him his life as he turns and just drops the finger. All the while, lone druid still doing druid things, which is off tier 1 tower, so it's victory all over the place for E-Home.
Now the Nyx starts to get out of control, unless FCD can find that favorable fight, which they need to get level 11 on Venomancer. This is where he's like, got to buy those Tomb of Knowledge. There's one in 10 seconds time, but
yeah,
him getting level 11 is probably the biggest kind of development in terms of levels go, and then the Nyx with the Blink probably the other big change that we can see come FTD's way.
Yeah. Alright, one outer tower remains. The druid starting to put some damage into it. Ice, 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 just dancing around the tree line here with the alchemist, continuing to harass him back.
Oh man, this greedy bench. He's 2-1 himself? Gosh.
Wow.
That's not a support play.
Yeah.
Pretty hole, please.
Uh-oh, smoke from FTD. What are they going to find? Gets broken on the Undying. Ice, 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 with beautiful positioning here. Basically reveals the smoke. They've got vision from the wards that Rubik's stolen, and what an annoying spell to have in their arsenal. Now they've got all this intel about these rotations. A noble effort for FTD, but it just gets completely scouted.
Yeah, that's actually a handy spell to have as a Rubik.
Yeah.
You want to just keep spamming until like, you see a bigger spell, like maybe an impale inside of a team could be better, but this is like the stage.
Blink Kagamwana onto the Nyx, comes out straight away from Undying. Undying still hasn't leveled his ultimate.
That's... surely not good.
It's definitely worth level 1 point this stage of the game. The magic amp is significant. 20% is huge.
don't think he should have the level point at this stage of game at level 9.
Music.
Fair enough. No, but it's, I mean, even the slow is helpful, you know?
Yeah, to me, there's like no, I can't think of any logic not Radiant's to get an ulti point right now.
Yeah. I mean, it's just that last point in Tombstone or last point in Decay is such a minor bump relative to everything the ult gives. But at least he has been able to pick up mech. That is one good item for FTD that has given them at least a little bit of a chance. Uh-oh, TP from Alf interrupted by Ice Ice Ice, but he's all alone. He's just going to perform away. That's a classic Ice 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 play there. Just interrupt the TP and walk away.
Yep. The whole time he's had this like annoying Alk replicate, putting top lane, farming top lane.
Yeah.
He actually may end this game as Demon 5 home hero because of the replicate.
Yeah. He's catching up to the lone druid, surprisingly, only 900 net worth away. Like that. Or
he's actually staying on the strength build too. This is normally what you see out of the offlane Morphling, but it's just with how much farm he's got, he could legitimately go into an Ethereal Blade and go Agi more.
Yeah. But now Rubick steals that stun, gets the impale. Pretty nice spell to have when they have a line on their team. You get basically like the double earth spike going on.
Yeah. I just don't see what FTD can do at this stage. There's like no good, like the kind of draft they have, this Undying Venomancer was all about like 5-man pushing and team fighting, but they're not pushing, they're playing defensive, and that doesn't work for their draft. I think Alk is almost, there is a legitimate kind of argument to just rushing an Axe Head to give to someone like Venomancer right now, because amplifying their team fight is a better way to turn the game around than Alk trying to solo carry. Alk is not going to be able to solo carry against the Puritan, but what they can try and do is team fight, because they need a Venowax to do so, maybe even like a Dying Axe. So I think, if anything, Alk pulling an Axe right now would probably be FTD's best bet. But
I wonder if they're considering that, because Veno could have gone for the Axe. Instead, he invested in a Force Staff. I mean, obviously, a much different cost, but he was still about halfway there. So perhaps expecting the Alchemist to help him out in that regard. We'll see Ice 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 make some space in the mid lane here while his team finishes off Roche. FTD are going to rotate in. They're going to get there just in time, but it's a moment too late. Agency Immortal goes with the Timbersaw. Fenrir taking a lot of damage, but Ice 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 in the back line joins the party. They'll lose the Rubick. Timbersaw is the one with the agency. He's doing a lot of damage so far. Chuck right in the middle of the fray. Ehome splitting this up, though. It's just Ice 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 in the middle of the fight now. Gets stunned on top of the Acid Spray as the rest of his team backs out. He'll be able to survive. Lanham in the Roche pit. Not going to be so lucky. Old Chicken might actually end up losing the Aegis here, doing a lot of damage to the Nyx before he falls, but the Aegis will be proc. Pretty good for FTD, they don't stop the Roche, but a lot of Nyx kills. The Timber Chain's actually off the mark. Nyx Assassin walks right into the Warp Death. Chris him a kill there, but now the Alpha hops in 2-4 step forward. Concoction channeling connects with the stun, and I think they should be able to bring down the Timdog side.
Bloodstone,
not to use it. It's an unstoppable streak, but he does finish the Alchemist before he falls. Well, after he falls. Still a nice turnaround, and now the Nesis, they should be able to get the Venno. So in the end, turns out okay for Ehome, but FTD do get a fair bit out of that.
Yeah, that clip Tombstone at the Roche pit always very effective, and that's kind of where Ehome got a little bit caught out. Morphling actually waits to the high ground to try and kill the Tombstone, and Ben's like, nah, you're not doing that, I'm going to swap you down. So it was a cool play from Pretty Hard to get the Morphling off the Tombstone, but...
Is Ice 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 going for an Octarine Core?
Yeah, he is.
Got a bolt there. Uh-oh, Mid-Lane Undying, walking too far forward. Lana in the finger, but he comes out and he actually survives for now. Chicken tried pursuit by the now vent. Hot pursuit, swap, magic missile. Oh, Chicken, he's been off more than he could chew here. They actually drop the Flesh Golem and Tombstone. Nyx goes in, and there's the suicide. It's another death for the Timbersaw. He's a bit overzealous there in lane.
You get this far ahead, you get this farm, you sometimes make those cocky plays. He's got this low respawn time, even on that second death still, he's back in 15 seconds. Yeah. I think it's double time, but he needs to be a little bit careful about how he plays moving forward.
Octarine Morphling, very interesting.
I mean, this is all about his cooldowns. The 10 second stun going down to a 7.5 second stun.
Speaking of stuns, yeah.
And the replicate cooldown, when he's using that Alchemist to farm for him, well, you can now have a shorter cooldown on that replicate. You have got much higher uptime.
Yeah.
It's actually, the duration now matches the cooldown with the replicate.
So now you can be a little more aggressive with it if it gets picked off. You're not really too upset. Yeah, that's pretty nice. Smoke rotation here from Ehome.
And
another Alchemist here. Yeah. He has picked up the Mantis style. They steal the illusion. Alka's still farming pretty well though here, gods. 17k net worth. He's moved ahead of the Morphling by a nice little margin. At least now he can split push the lanes with the Manta style. Really accelerated form. The Eho obviously still in great shape, holding on to it. 12k net worth, but still yet to break the high ground.
Yeah. They've got the hero to at least go high ground. If you didn't have a high ground pushing hero like the Druid, you'd be a little worried for him. Like, well, Alchemist is going to get 6 slotted, and it's going to pull Acceptance to heroes that have great Acceptance upgrades, but stage 3 time, you're still feeling pretty confident that you can this game.
By the to start things, the pill fall, Mayan go down and straight to one woman and get things started too. Some focus card, Soul Rift, not going to be enough to keep alive. Venomous Yell coming around the back, but the Druid just turns and tries to fight him. Meanwhile, Ice charges in the front lines, pushes back the rest of FTD alongside Old Chicken as they do finish off the Venomancer on the backside. 2 for 2 though, and they need to fight for FTD. It's not over yet. Is Old Chicken now locked down at the high ground? E-Home all split up, and again, a bit overzealous. Ice still sticking around. They're going on a pretty hard waveform forward. The Bear comes in to finish him off. There is an Assault Kuros on this Bear now, so he's hitting pretty hard and pretty damn fast. It's a 3 for 3 as it looks like things will settle down and E-Home go back towards the Tier 3. Alchemist, ready to make a defense here. 2-on-1, he needs to be a little bit careful.
Yes.
Look how fast they siege though. You're absolutely right, guys. They can just chew through these buildings.
This Alchemist being constantly plagued by adaptive strikes.
Yeah,
this
brutal.
Is, I guess the plan is to spam the stuns on the Alchemist while you just fight and kill everyone else. But that was a pretty good fight for FTD.
Mm-hmm.
Right on top in the 3 for 3 trade with a bit of a gold edge. And...
Yeah, again, the last 10 minutes or so has been pretty plateaued around that 10k net worth mark. Yeah, E-Home has really not accelerated their lead by much since then.
Yeah, a couple overextensions here and there from Old Chicken, and I like this choice. He's actually going to go for a BKB, not the Agon Interceptor on the Timbersaw, and that really solves all his problems in these team fights.
Yeah.
He can't play how he's doing without a BKB, so...
Yeah, definitely makes sense. Alchemist grabs that Invis rune there, and he's actually pretty close to Ocarina of his own, has the Soul Booster, and just a couple minutes of farming, we'll see that gold number jump up quite a bit. Though Home grouped up his 5, it looks like they're ready to try and just 5-man push into the base and actually take some objectives here. I believe the Glyph is down for the Dire side. Yeah, they've got a nice window here where that and stop the sieging. Even taking by leading the Bear on the Tier 3 part, hard to deal with.
Yeah, you can't really waste any of your stuns control on the Spirit Bear for fights about to break out. So.
Right.
Difficult for them to approach these team fights and these high ground defenses against the Spirit Bear. Mm-hmm. Looks like E-Home, they're now keeping up their map. They've put 3-4 heroes in the lone druid bottom, so a bit more split push oriented perhaps moving forward.
Yeah. Alright, well, this is the problem for FTD. They're just all twirled up in their base right now. You take a look at Dire Vision, and they've got one Humble Ward down, and it's near their secret shop. Really no idea where E-Home are, where they're going to strike, and meanwhile, their jungle's just getting cleared out, so they're really getting starved. I think that's the biggest factor, and how do you come back when you're just completely locked in your base and have no map control like this?
The comeback is really that one big team fight that you win.
Mm.
And... Alright, I mean, winning, or even it doesn't have to be a decisive win, but just taking team fights is going to be the plan where you've got to try and use your high ground advantage because you haven't got any vision out of the map. You need to kind of fight around strong points.
You got to use that +3 armor buff, man. It's pretty big.
Yeah, it's actually crazy how much high ground defense got buffed in this patch.
Yeah, that and the tower moving back is really big.
Yeah.
That's one of those changes that feels small, but it's really hard to just slow seed into the low ground now. You really have to commit a lot more to chip at that tower.
Yeah, the positioning puts you in such a dangerous spot where you can get engaged on by the high ground defenders.
Yeah. BKB now up on the Timbersaw though. So go full man mode in this next fight. Ice as well as the Alchemist going at it again. And Alchemist already caught the Ocarine Core.
And I just have to find the Alchemist just to make the replicates.
Yeah. Yeah, the replicates do pretty damage. Have half of a hero or so on your team. But here we go, high ground siege, still no for the Bear side. Bear goes up to the high ground, just takes tower and jumps into the mouth. Blood does have another Bear. Happy to let this one just take some damage. Lone Druid also is holding onto a Gem of Truth site, so he's going to sit pretty far in the back. Clearing out some illusions here. They do get the tier at the tower mid, so the barracks are exposed. TPing back in.
So the hybrid Morphling now. Good stuff. Can he cast Spirit Bear? I guess he can.
this target allied hero, so I don't think so.
No, I didn't. He creates an illusion of a teammate. He Morphling turns into a teammate, mm-hmm. is how this works. So,
right.
And you get their spell. So here you can cast Spirit Prayer and have a double Spirit
Prayer. Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I thought you'd become the bear.
Oh, no, no, yeah.
No, I don't think you can do that.
He'll become the lone druid, but then he might
summon the bear. Yeah, I think you should be able to. I don't see why not.
That sounds like something Isis would do, even though your Spirit Bear has no items, but...
Still, I mean, just having another bear to split push like that is annoying at the very least.
Otherwise, making a Timbersaw is pretty good. You don't get the ultimate. Rubik Lion on the next great, so...
Oh, here we go. Quite gonna break out in the mid. Hold 11 to the front line. Lone Druid actually taking a lot of damage. Remember, he's a gem narrative and finger death. Comes out on Venomancer. He's still holding on to the ultimate. He has a BKB as well yet to use. Old Chicken has his magic immunity on, soon to expire. He's getting pretty deep into the base here. FTD just desperately trying to disengage, get back to the well and heal up so they can take another fight on the high ground and actually defend the barracks. Another Alchemist, the Replicate, coming in here. Pushing everybody back with a lot of half the damage with the Radiant Burn. Ice, tanking a lot of damage in the front line as well. Ehome not split up here, and with all the taking so much damage at the beginning of that fight, he was a little hesitant to just run up to the high ground. Now FTD feeling confident moving after the bait. Acid Spray comes down, the case for the second, so they jump in and defend rear. Finally, the poison oak comes out of Venomancer, so they get to kill on the straight away. Old Chicken doesn't have his BKB available for another 30 seconds. They have to be a little bit careful here. Ice in pretty deep. The suicide, actually, from the Timbersaw finishes off the Nyx Assassin. They do lose their line, and it's not a great fight for Ehome. They've already lost three, and now they're our retreat.
Yeah, with three kind of successful takes.
That's a good hold. I mean, again, they lost tier three. The barracks topped off. Range didn't even take a single tick of damage. No buybacks used. That's really impressive. Well, I'm starting to feel like this might not be totally over for FTD gods.
No, it definitely does not feel over at all. Ehome, I mean, like, perhaps having a bit, taking this game a bit too casually in some way. Like, the first Rocket test really was where they lost the Aegis and didn't get to go for a high ground siege with an Aegis, but now they're trying to take ground without taking Roche again. Ice is just kind of having some fun. He's playing spectacularly well, but it's funny to see him. He was controlling three different, like, heroes in the fight. His own hero, the Morphling, he just saw Hybrid, and he had the Morphling Replicate. The Replicate exactly, but he still does a lot in the team fight, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, Tim was enough, and he had a split, so.
Impressive.
Very interesting stuff.
Yeah, Old Chicken just back up here. They're actually in pretty deep in the top lane. Smooth Agon and Scepter now at that point, but I imagine that'll be natural item progression for him if this game is on. Waveform forward down to the bottom lane, pretty tall target of choice, but does make it back in time to not fall victim to the Morphling. Roshan, on the other hand, this is Rosh number two. Ehome move right into the pit, and it looks like they might get this one uncontested. FTD not making a movement quite yet. Looking at their vision, very limited. They will use a scan. No, they didn't. What was that?
That was a TPN, please?
Oh, TPN, okay.
Yeah,
that's the weirdest scan I've ever seen.
That scan looks like, yeah, that scan looks like,
that's my bad.
Yeah. They look quite similar.
Yeah. Oh, Duplicate down bottom. It's buffed up by the Alcon action here. But still space created for the Roche to fall in. It's the Timbersaw that takes Aegis.
Timbersaw's kind of that key hero as far as the actual fight go.
Yeah.
He's the one you need dishing out damage.
Alk pretty far out, pretty hard with a swap to save him, but Venge will have to sacrifice herself to keep the carry alive. And now Alk gets stunned, BKB Venom. He has the poison over ready, but this Alk in some trouble. Pops the Mander, will be able to back up for now. Hex comes out, Steph on the run. BKB starting to fall off here. Old Chicken in the front line. Running low on mana, precious resource to put out this big damage. And stolen swap to Fenrir. Pulls the Alchemist back in a hard way. He's actually genning pretty quickly. It will cost Fenrir his life. Aren't they actually going to be able to bring him down? He's pretty damn tanky. Line him off to the side. Locked in the trees. Just falls to all the poison damage. And again, this fight for Ehome really not going that well. It's a 1-for-2 out of the gate. Ice goes charging in. Start to lose the brain here. Chase. Alchemist charging. Stop. Looks like he next. And Drew is in a lot of trouble. It looks like Ice on the left, moving around trees. He's actually still alive. Ice doing everything he can to block them out. They can't get to the druid. It's a radius burn. A radius burn. Take him down. Ice. He'll make it. Now Old Chicken. He went. Dark Kenny. And the Timbersaw is going to have to do this one the old-fashioned way. Concoction connects. That's going to be the end of the Aegis. Oh my.
Yeah, but I'm legitimately concerned at this stage about this game. They're low druid, like, isn't your Timber aren't getting enough done in the fight. They've got this huge economic investment in the Morgue. I mean, mostly Ice had such a great game, but he's not got these. Like, it almost feels like he should have gone for just carry DPS items at this stage to help push, yeah, as well as just scale into the late game, because
feels like his damage is pretty minimal in these fights, honestly.
Yeah. And the Alk replicates are much more geared towards farming rather than actually fighting. They don't do a whole lot in a fight.
Well, and they already have a Radiance on the lone druid as well, yeah, and that's a lot of the damage that comes out of the illusion.
So, very much a case where FTD are taking teamfight after teamfight, and big concern, because Alchemist is going to start pulling Ag Scepters, so these FTD utility heroes like Venno and Undying are just going to get scarier and scarier. Nyx, another great, all four of these amazing Ag heroes.
Yeah, they really are.
Like, these four are probably like all top tax candidates in the game.
Yeah, you're right. Even the Undying in the support role, just getting that extra strength steal is huge against some of these tankier heroes. Even the Morphling, Mental Spirit now caught in mid lane, big damage coming out on pretty hot. Matt comes and FTD want to try to actually take this fight. Pretty Hawk's still alive. Glimmer Cave topped him off. And now they're going to go in on the Ice. They've already killed the Lion. Some reinforcements coming for Ehome here, but it looks like they will disengage. Lion's the only one that falls, but remember, that fight started as Ehome trying to gank the Ven, and they didn't even trade one for one.
From the defensive play coming out just from the item, the pipe and glimmer cape, the Ven should swap throughout this game. Ven are going to KB. There's a lot of sustain on this FTD side, and it's really nice these fights.
Yeah, and here 38 minutes FTD get their first tower kill. Talk about turn of momentum.
Well, these towers are just literal money bags at this stage. If FTD start winning buttons and taking a few more towers, it's going to quickly see a big upswing going their direction. We're already seeing it.
Here we go.
To some extent.
First Aghanims. Who's it going to? I think the Venno is probably the highest priority.
Yeah. Level 16, he's also like really farm ready, which just means he's going to be staying alive as a greater guarantee gets it off.
And these itemized, pretty much guaranteed good ultimate. He can blink and force have to get in position.
Yep. Nyx is the other really good one, but is this Nyx? Is it Nyx or Venno? Okay, good Nyx.
Oh, okay.
Nyx is just like a... Oh, I mean, Nyx to me is like
Nyx
3.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible. I think it's just more the way these fights have been going that the Venno ultimate has really been a key piece of their damage.
Yeah. The Nyx is more, like, you get more utility and control out of it. You get the guaranteed stun with the Spike Carapace, with the Burrow. You get a shorter cooldown on your Impale. So.
And it's a little better for high ground defense, I guess. More spammable. And whereas the Venno's is obviously more cooldown related.
You can just sit in the front lines, go Burrowed, and. Is there a threat of dying if you're Burrowed? I guess, yeah, the Timbersaw has some pure damage, so he can't just go complete frontline Burrow up, but.
Yeah.
But he if you're out, you're probably just saying, look, don't worry, Venno, I'll have another acceptor in. Well, I've actually got money for it now. He's got 6.4k gold suddenly.
He just bought hey. Yeah, she just bought a blade nail of all items. Not sure about her.
Is it, I mean, it's replacing armlet.
Yeah.
Great item against him as well, I guess.
Classically, playing item meals ought to be missed, though. And he does upgrade to his first, so now he can keep you.
Yeah, it's like 40 minutes in, I'm 6 slotted, what do I do? Let's buy blade mail. That's not like a typical 6 slotted item that you'd think of.
Pretty low ticket, I think.
Yeah. With buffs, yeah, I don't mind. He's got green with it, so it reduces the cooldown, something that kind of got taken away in the recent 8-7.
That's a fair point. 13.5 seconds is pretty damn good.
It does very much help with the
Timbersaw. 11 gets caught, and there the BOTs from the Alchemist joins this fight right away. Concoct and Chargeman gets forced stab forward, next to the stun on the Druid, and I think they're going to fight a kill on old 11 here. He's going down pretty fast. Undying trying to box him out and cut off all paths to retreat. That's going to be a gem down. Looking to kill his replicate, slow and steady. Be able to pick it off, but great kill here for FTD. I think Evo might just kind of turn this into a rat game. They were split pushing, and they did kill that tier tower up top a couple minutes ago. So they are still kind of whittling down the base. Ice getting close to the tier 3 in the bottom lane.
Definitely a good option. I mean, Ice going into the maelstrom is kind of a pseudo split pushing item, so also to help him scale more towards the late game.
Yeah.
And as far as ways of dealing with split push, it's the Alchemist as a carry who can help deal with the split push, and then to a slightly smaller extent than Nyx with his pick off and kill potential, but I mean, he can't solo kill heroes, they're too ultra tanky.
Yeah. Timbersaw's down to 2 Bloodstone charges. That's actually worrying.
Yeah. That item is quickly fallen off.
Yeah, he's just died so many times since he took it up. Seems like right after he bought the item, they took a bad fight and then they overextended in the mid and he had to suicide almost right away. So those charges just disappeared. Fenrir in pretty deep here in the top lane. He does have a blink dagger and a TP. Should be able to make it out as long as he blinks in time. But Nyx Assassin's here with detection. And this should be an easy pickoff. Coming up to the pocket, guaranteed stun. Oh my.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
I don't want to pick up on the Agrania 6 part, so he's going to get out. Allowing him to always join in for these inks.
Yeah.
But Nyx, not having it, they have the best solo kill potential, but he never needs to be solo when the option can be in.
Yeah, that's a good point. Attack. Ice. Still doing a good job split pushing, though. Gets a lot of damage into that tier 3 tower bottom. Almost finishes it off.
He's being tracked up by the Nyx here, but not a kill he can get.
Yeah.
He's harassed
with especially with the Lincolns. So another Aghanim should be on the way for Alk pretty soon here. He's got 3k gold.
He's got 2-point boosters. He bought 2-point boosters in the side shop and completed one with an Ag. He's saving money for buyback.
So he gave one to Venno, so he's pulled 2 now. And he's got another 3,100 gold with plenty for buyback.
And he already has, like, he's already gearing up for that Ag Scepter. Oh, I think FTD actually a lead right now. At this stage...
Yeah, it's a 2k net worth lead. That's nothing.
The fifth you can redistribute the Alchemist's wealth to these supports and everything is a huge deal.
Yeah.
In the late game. The damage output for Eno is capable in these spots. With the Morphling's build and with Undying, Itemized the way you're having, like, it's going Crimson Guard now to go with the Pipe and the Mech.
Mm-hmm.
Ben just swap saving anyone who gets going on. Like Eno having legit issues killing anyone in the fight.
Yeah. I mean, even the Timbersaw, he went for a much more defensive build. Bloodstone, BKB, Ocarine, no Aghanims for that extra damage output, and it feels like they could really use it. I mean, Rubick, some limited on Spellseek and Steel in terms of damage output. There's a lot of decent stuns, some good control, Plague Ward annoying, but you know, actually stealing something like the Poison Nova is proving to be pretty difficult.
Axe number 3.
Oh my. So this one going to Undying, I think?
Undying Revenge, similar.
Honestly, this it feels like it really doesn't matter. He's going to be able to get both of them in the next couple minutes anyway. It
doesn't matter. It's not even worth really crafting too much if FTD is whichever is closest to you and promise the other another one in the next 90 seconds.
Yeah. Bench has already been pretty on point with these swaps, and I feel like the Undying Ags is... They do give it to the Undying, but it just gives you that ability to really take advantage of Ehome if they position themselves poorly in the next fight.
If you're the Venge, you're like, man, come on, shoot me one soon. How many times did I save you this game?
Fenrir. Oh, he actually blinks out. The Nyx Assassin misses the stun, so he gets that pick up a little bit more quickly. And he's able to make it away before the out TP's in. Nice player.
This game is just going way too late. Like, it was never... That was the thing. We talked about it being all in on, like, their... Alchemist, he could do really well. If they don't do well, the only alternative is to go super late game and pull a bunch of axes. Just they're at that stage where everyone's going to... Alk has another 5k gold. He just bought an axe and he suddenly has...
He can eat a moon shard soon.
Oh, yeah, at least he's done that, but... No, not too big a deal. I mean, he's randomizing towards just being tanky rather than dealing damage.
Yeah.
Fine, because he's got such a strong high ground defense in this game.
Uh-oh, Ice. Actually going to get caught here. He goes a little too deep into the base.
Wow.
He falls surprisingly fast.
Yeah, he's...
Ouch.
Not a big threat anymore. He's finally gone Agimorph, but he hasn't got the items that really play around being an Agimorph.
Yeah. I mean, the one good thing for Ehome now is they've actually killed all tier 3 towers. So if they do win just one team fight and get to the base, they can basically end this in one fell swoop.
Yeah.
I mean, easier said than done, but they are kind of right on the edge of doing crippling damage in this game.
Yeah. In some ways, it's like a one fight and done kind of Ehome. But I mean, I would... Buybacks need to be taken into consideration. Alchemist always, he's waiting until he can buy back and next time before he buys next.
Yeah. Is the fight breakout, man? They call it again. Alk joining the team. He picked the kill. It's Assassin's Revenge that really set it up. I mean, Alk is actually getting to the point where he's almost completely capped. I mean, you could replace the blade mail for something a little more expensive. You could eat a moon shard. He could eat an Aghanim's on himself. And I think beyond that, what else can he really do with his gold?
Yeah, he's very much... Well, I guess he can replace the blade mail, moonshot.
Yeah, so he still has a couple more to go, but after that, it's pretty much it. I guess you start working on that that courier wardrobe.
Buy gems, buy wards for your team, buy the team.
Yeah. Yeah,
like a necro book or something on the courier, a refresher on the courier.
I don't think Icy is a big core item for him this game. Perhaps Abyssal Blade is slightly tempting, but
yeah. I'm so curious about the Blade. So far since he's picked it up, it hasn't really seemed to do too much. He actually used the Poison Nova on the bear here.
Sure, why not?
All right, 300 gold.
You get, well, I'm not sure on the mechanic works, if you get the life book from the inflator damage with the Octarine Core.
Ooh.
It's not like a reason to buy the Blade on, so like you're generally buying Octarine purely for the cooldowns and the life steal's like an added bonus, but I don't know how that works.
I guess the question is damage turn considered a spell? Like, are actives the spells in terms of game?
Well, like, great damage is like, you get life steal at staying on stuff, so.
So I would say, I'm tempted, yes.
Yeah, as well, but it's different. Is Albus inflicting the damage, or is the hero inflicting it on himself? I'm laying for the soul.
Interrupt the TP. I'm actually for a surprise amount of time, bringing him down. Dominating streak goes the way of Timbersaw. All the while, Old 11 is just pushing up top.
Yeah. E-Hum, it's split push to victory. This game's still far from secure for FTD, despite how much they've turned things around. They've got a net worth advantage. All of their heroes above 10k net worth, thanks to the Alchemist, but it's just...
And especially now, Undying doesn't have a buyback, so he's out of the game for 5 seconds here, and Roche number 3 is up, so they're going to be able to secure Aegis and Cheese, I think.
And it's very really hard for FTD just to win the game. Like, yes, you turn things around and you can team fight really well and all that, but you've got to be able to push out your lane and contest E-Home to win this game, and E-Home's just going to be trying to play that rat over style.
Yeah. FTD do want to contest this, though, 4v5.
Yeah, E-Home don't want to mess around. They don't want to take any kind of a team fight, I believe.
Ice. He says differently. He hops up there, gets the ref kit. And now they have another scouting tool. And you're right, man. They get out of the pit and they just go right back to the lane. Start pushing things out. Now that Undying's up, they're definitely not interested in lingering around. Man. It feels like E-Home are a lot more timid now. Very cautious about taking any kind of engagement.
They just don't have that teamfight hero. That's the thing. Like, you look at what who's bringing anything to a teamfight. They haven't got any... There, I guess if you can hit a multiple hero Earthspike, that's pretty handy. There's no huge game-changing spells for Rick's still, really.
I think Poison Nova is really the only one.
Yeah.
Maybe the Decay, it's Ags upgraded.
Well, he needs Ags himself first.
He's quite there.
Okay, would be nice if he, when he gets his Ags separate.
Yeah.
Stunned
up, in comes the Alk. KB to use TP home. Old chicken survives. Now, meanwhile, in the bottom lane, Nyx TP's home. Back to Morphling. Right back into the road. We go. Home. Trying to make this happen, but again, a little bit scary. Nyx going lurker mode up on the high ground. Gets stun on two. This time it seems like they want to commit for it though. This is very risky here, guys. Roche much tankier than he used to be. Nice stun from Lanham though. Next on quite a few. Meteor hops in as well. Looks like they'll make space for the Roche to fall. They will trade their line away though. Timbersaw the one to grab the Aegis again. They leave the cheese in the pit. Looks like it will be picked up by the Undying. Old Chicken swap back to the ground. This fight's getting very spread out and not looking good for E-Home. Old 11, isolated on the side. He's going to TP out. It's going to be close, but it does get interrupted. Swap as well as stun. Now the Druid's going to be on the run. Rubick in the middle of the fray, just trying to make some space for the Druid to get home. But now the Shiva's guard comes out. They've got another stun. And Old 11 will end up falling. Looks like everyone else besides the line will make it out.
And Morphling immediately just TPing the split push towards mid lane. But very much like there's any fight with some similar numbers is going to be lost heavily by him. There's just too much of this hero position advantage for FTD in any kind of a team fight, and surprised E-Home are trying to forcing so much around the Roche, but they get caught, they get punished. Getting the Aegis this stage not really particularly worth it in my mind. It's like you've got to be kind of looking for the forward on that.
And handing cheese over is
really eats into the value of Roche. Like, considering that was already risky, Undying, I think, would be pretty happy to have a free push in here. Full heat for him. And now X on the Venno. Man, he is so far.
Getting the Morphling a little bit more possible. Glad to link him here, but seems to at least take away his way to replicate out or morph strength or something.
Yeah. Looks like Scotty's gonna be the next item of choice here for Morphling. He's picked up the ooh. He's got 9k gold, so he can definitely afford it.
Yeah, I'm thinking he just wants kind of quick switch items like butterfly type things, but Scotty's not bad. Lots of stats.
Gold chicken. Force uses BKB again. He's all by himself. And it looks like he'll survive.
Fast fingers on BKB. Buys time for his team to rotate, and like you say, he'll survive and he'll fall back.
Still a BKB on cooldown though. Looks like XTD will take that opportunity to just move into this tower.
Mm. I'm sort of a hybrid leading the way here, but very much just there to try and stop and delay this push.
Yeah, this could end up being a really long game. Even though FTD are holding on, like you were saying, it's really hard for them to actually push out and control the game. It's one thing to hold the high ground, but something completely different for them to actually push high ground themselves. Hey, they're struggling just to push a 2-1 tower right now.
Like Full Chicken is a Timbersaw, like high ground defense Timbersaw, always fantastic. Throwing an axe to his holder. He's up here.
Yeah, not expecting that for the Venom. They're 4-staff away. Swap from the Rubik. That'll buy him some more space. Now the ult from Venno, though, doing pretty big damage. The Aegis goes down. They're going to try to pursue on defend here. He's pulling the poison over. Connects on two. Old Chicken comes back to life. And actually, we'll start back out. The Alchemist has to go home to deal with Ultra Fling. Rubik looks pushed off by Venno. Old Chicken trying to pursue on behalf of the King. Set his ice here. They can't quite deal with this. SSS is there. He's going to start to clear out this creep. On backside, looks like the Undying probably going to go down, but Ice is not fair in the bottom lane. He's on the roof, just like Phaser, he's going to fall as well.
This is the play for you, home. Create chaos and then go for the push. They get bottom racks. The Morphling as well as the Lone Druid, both kind of committing to the buildings while their teammates die. And net win for Ehome. They don't really care about losing a couple of lives if they're getting racked, because again, FD themselves do not push.
Yeah, especially just the two supports. At this point, they're basically expecting the supports to die in these team fights from all the passive damage coming out. Ice, though, locked down. It's a 4-on-1 scenario. He's not going to survive this one. The bear stuck in the tree line here, actually on the high ground, and he will just be able to return it back.
Okay. I think bear, oh, I was about to say, bear should get an axe if he's already got one. I like it. Just to allow his Spirit Bear to be split pushing these lanes and actually attacking buildings if it ever gets to the high ground.
Yeah.
Without his hero need to be there.
Old Chicken stunned up, pops the BKB, and will just TP out.
At some point, I guess they don't have the damage if they go for the straight impale without. I mean, Vendetta, even if they hit the impale there, I don't think they get that kill, so.
Yeah. More big items, though, gods.
Yeah, so Timbersaw Axe, this is. Basically, Timbersaw is the I'm gonna fight you / defend high ground while my team go and rat you.
Yeah. Ooh, definitely the play, but FTD, they're gonna push out of the base here. Yeah, they grab the lone druid and get the tombstone down. Pretty good damage here.
Save the Spirit Fair. You have Axe Scepter. If you save Spirit Fair, it's fine. Spirit Fair is actually the more important build than lone druid. They swap the Spirit Fair back in.
And it's done. Very smart play for Pretty. It's so worth that cooldown to get the kill bear here.
Yeah.
And lone druid is actually down without a buyback. This is huge. Morphling has up in third, but he's probably going to be four much. They're going to dive into the base, damage on the old chicken, pretty good cost of BCB. Ultra Venno, do a lot of damage here, fair fall, so quick to magic damage. Confused by Ehome, and my gosh, it feels like FE here dead for over a minute.
Morphling can split push when he's back. He may just go for that mid or top rack as soon as he respawns. We'll have to see how FTD responds to this.
There's tier 2 towers in both side lanes. So they need to get the barracks and back, or they need to commit for tier 4s. They have to decide what the play is and will back up.
Throwing's very difficult. You put yourself in a dangerous position, so. They back off and maybe looking to re-engage here, actually.
Yeah, they've still got to be happy, though, with Elaine Barrack at this point. Now swap on the old chicken. They've got the head right away. He's stunned. He's taking a lot of damage. This could be huge if they can bring him down. He pops the BKB now. It's pretty hard that actually dies first. Ice in the front line doing as much damage as he can, but it's not enough to keep Timber alive. He'll fall, but has a buyback available. More good stuff for FTD here.
Molt may look to help some of these side lanes. He's got a replicate as well. Oh no, he loses his replicate, so. Hasn't made a commitment to TP just yet. And he'll see Alchemist back at base, so he's not going to go that way.
I think it's definitely time this alchemist eats a moon shard. 15,000 gold. It's just a dent into that.
He was even by the side shop of the secret shop early. I'm like, is he gonna do it? He realizes. Come on, dude. Get your moon shard.
So, and I'm waiting for this blade mail to make sense to me, and it still doesn't feel too helpful in these fights. I mean, what else would he replace it with this one? Maybe a heart, maybe the abyssal, like you mentioned.
Looks like a hex.
Okay.
He buys a hex.
And he eats.
Okay, moon shard plus hex replaces blade mail. Okay.
I like that.
It's one of those things where it feels like a game breakdown at the end. If we could see how much damage he was getting out of this blade mail in these fights, maybe it would make more sense to us. Because
yeah, that's true.
I think it's one of those items we just don't quite see how damage he's doing. And he's getting kind of controlled by telekinesis and stuff, and that's where you just pop your blade mail and you can get guaranteed damage.
That's true. Morphling is now pick a butterfly. The question is, does he replace?
He needs to replace all these utilities. His carry mode.
Yeah.
I say crap, these items were obviously very effective early on.
That crappy Octarine core, you know.
Yeah, who wants one of those?
The Axe Age, he has to transition, you're absolutely right.
This Axe has actually been a complete dud. Like, all these, he's made hybrids of the Timbersaw, which is like, you know, to kind of initiate in a little bit, use some Timber Chains and Whirling Jets, but I haven't been impressed by the Axe's impact on this game.
Yeah.
I haven't seen him make a Lone Druid hybrid, because pretty sure you can make spirit bears, but an animal with spirit bears is not scary.
Especially at this stage of the game, yeah. Ice, still split pushing though. He's down in the bottom lane while the rest of the team defends up top. Scan used by the Radiant here. You can see a hell of a lot.
And they want to, that's the whole idea behind these hexes, is that you can stop the split push, because that's if you recognize they're going to lose this game, is if they get split pushed up, so.
Yep, two hexes, two Lotus Orbs. Itemizing pretty wise here, I think.
Yeah, wouldn't be surprised to see, like, at this stage, everyone just go Hex your Nyx, your Venge, whoever.
Yeah.
Dyer's
all right, things out a little bit here, guys. We're about to pass that hour mark, and this is... I mean, even if FTD end up losing this game, this is still a pretty impressive showing. Remember, eHome are top of the group, and FTD are bottom. They are putting up one great fight here.
Yeah, this is...
This has been a very interesting game.
Yeah.
For the reason.
Nyx getting TP'd on here by the Venno Hex there, but they I think with Nyx a few more heroes, they quickly realize that it's not a fight they want to take.
Yeah.
So it's a secondary level 2 boots of travel, so giving them more global ganking initiating potential.
Yep. Bear just split push the bottom lane while this fight breaks out up top, it looks like. Take a look at Vision here. eHome.
As our SCP, you will take this fight just so they can rat anything. This is where you're trying to engage and then send either the bear bottom or the morphling bottom to try and backdoor some of these other lanes of racks, but...
Yeah, they're just going to disengage, they even pull the bear back.
Okay, so... Ideally, you have someone like Timbersaw, forced to engage into a fight with buyback, and then he can die as long as your teammate, as long as someone like morphling gets a racks or two. Mm-hmm. So far for now, eHome just want to play things slow and steady.
Roche 4 is up. Another Aegis cheese, but both sides don't really have great Roche lineup. I mean, Alk, I guess, with the acid spray, go pretty quickly, but it seems like every time eHome has tried to move into the Roche pit, it has ended in a lackluster fashion from their perspective.
Yeah. And neither the team has heroes that benefit a ton from an Aegis or cheese at this stage.
Yeah.
For FTD, maybe they're looking at, okay, it can help them push, but someone like a... Honestly, someone like a Venge probably takes Aegis at this stage.
Yeah, especially the way she's been playing, that kind of sacrificial Venrir. Venrir, I mean, a lot of trouble here, he gets fucked. And yeah, FTD just converge on him. That's a godlike streak now from Alchemist. He's 11, 4, and 16. Yeah, he's recovered pretty well.
800 CS, okay.
Yeah, he's at 60k net worth from his deal, and at this point where he's literally capped out now.
This is 60k net worth, where he's also pulled 16,000 net worth. He lost 16,000 net worth from those acceptors, so...
Yeah.
What are we looking at? GPM falls 70.
That is insane, though. All the rag is so real, though. There's only two melee barracks remaining. Ice pushes off, and he gets passed up. He's doing some damage here, but the vibe, he's gonna put... Well, the bear actually positioned off the melee barracks.
You think he's replicating just your other racks?
Yeah, you need to pop down off him, so he's a lot of damage. gets to his side. Lanham force staff back towards the high ground. FTD trying to split push as best they can, but they are in danger mode now. There's this one building sent between them and a certain demise.
It's strange because I don't actually know if Mechas is GG, like an alchemist of all heroes.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
one better hero than the whole off.
The effect is going to kill FTD to end this game.
Oh, here we go. Fighting the Raidy. They're going to go right in on Fen here. Pretty big damage. Slot back. Pretty tall, getting much more aggressive with his positioning. This Rubik is certain to fall. Buyback from the Timbersaw. Instant buyback from the Rubik as well. Eating home have to make a hold here, and it looks like they will. Pretty tall fall. Finger of Death comes out as well. FPD starting to back up and reset things a little bit.
No one's going for any backdoor play. If you TP in to try and backdoor that last rack, you're like committed. You can't come back unless you have a replicate, which is on cooldown in seconds. So Isis could do that soon. The Spirit Bear could go when he has boot to travel, which is up in 5 seconds. So we may even see the Spirit Bear boot to travel into the enemy base just to secure Mega Creep. Here we go. Maybe you consider going for Throne here. Ice. Heading towards the melee rack.
Buyback from Pretty Hall. He's going to try to buy time here, but remember, there's just no glyph available for the Dire side. Now they're going to send the bear up top. It is Mega Creep. Now the fight in the Radiant Bane. They kill the Rubik. No buyback available on hand. Looks like Lottom could fall as well. The poison damage is so much as he gets into the well.
Dire base game very low. The Spirit Bear and the Morphling here. This is actually disastrous.
It looks like Home's going to be able to do it. Ice doing huge damage when he gets stuck. The Link is just... They're actually going to be able to bring on the Morphling. The Bear's still here as well. But I don't think he's going to be able to finish off the throne. Or will he? It's getting so close here. Bob, try to back the swap. The Bear will fall. And Home actually can't close the... Yet 1k HP left on
the worrying that, like, for Ehome, they commit to buyback, could just try and suicide for the throne.
They have three throws with buyback to cool them. FTD, only Venge used hers to make that sense.
This is... I'd much rather be in Ehome's shoes right now, that's for sure, but it's definitely not one. Refresher for Alchemist, he's just gonna keep that in his stash for, like, buyback scenario where...
Yeah.
You can refresh, like, if his hex is on cooldown when he ties back, or his TP is on cooldown, you can just buy back, refresh his TP, and then TP in once more. So they push out the lane decently, but the Spirit Bear is up top, so all Ehome need is... I don't even know if they need creep in the base. They can, like, send the Spirit Bear in and TP the Morphling on it and go for the back door, but...
Yeah, it's so low, and there's no glyph. It's going to be down for another 2 minutes. FTD, they're going to go in here, and they're basically all in. They pick off a couple of these supports. That's where things get really scary for Ehome. Ehome don't have a glyph either. Lana gets blocked in. It's a dead lion. Buy back on him. Now they start going in onto the towers, but the Bear is hitting the throne. I think the Bear is going to be able to do it here, guys. They just don't have... the damage.
Question mark? Where's the backdoor protection?
That is a great question.
I don't know.
The creeps were at the base for so long, all the lanes were pushed out.
I mean, the Spirit Bear, that's a creep, you know?
Seriously, what the hell?
Yeah, I don't know. That's
my god. Well, Ehome, take it. But a rocky game, I think, to say the least, from the heavy favorites coming into this BO2.
That was very rocky. I mean, they should have won. They had things like in the bag at 25 minutes and then... couple bad fights. I mean, there was just so much gold invested in the Morphling who went for this pure utility, but